Well, good morning, and thank you for that welcome. Great to be with you here in Edinburgh this morning, and great welcome to you, and a big welcome to everybody watching on the video link from Leith, Granton, or at Church Online. For those of you watching at Church Online or one of the video links, the video camera tends to make me look shorter. I am, in fact, 6'3", as anyone here. That's what I've got, a kind response there. No, exactly. I may be about the same height, actually, as Greta Thunberg, but I'm not quite sure. We'll see. Well, if you've got a Bible with you this morning, we're going to open up the scriptures right at the top of the message, and we're going to take a dive into one of the perhaps most important chapters of the Bible on this whole topic we're looking at this morning of God and the environment. We're going to start in Genesis 1 in a moment. So if you've got a Bible with you or on your phone, and the great thing about Bibles on the phones, if the sermon is boring, you can read Candy Crush Saga. But I can, of course, see everybody from up here, so you won't get away with it. And then also, we're going to take a look at Psalm 24. So those are two sections of the Bible you might want to keep your finger in this morning. But Genesis chapter 1, as we begin thinking this morning about God and the environment, is a beautiful chapter of the Bible. You know, it describes how God calls everything into being by the power of his words. He speaks into existence stars and planets and galaxies, the planet Earth, and mountains and oceans and forests and plants and animals and birds. But then at the end of chapter 1 of Genesis, we come to this powerful few verses that talks about humankind and how we fit into the whole scheme. We'll pick it up at verse 26, where we read, "Then God said, 'Let us make humankind in our image, in our likeness, so they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and over all the wild animals and over all the creatures that move along the ground.' So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. God blessed them and said to them, 'Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea, over the birds in the sky, and over every living creature that moves along the ground.' Then God said, 'I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth, and to the birds of the sky, and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has the breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food.' And it was so. And God saw all that he had made, and it was very good." Well, that's Genesis chapter 1. Let's also, before we dive into this topic this morning, take a look at another passage of scripture that talks powerfully about creation and God's view of it, and that's Psalm 24. So we're just going to take a look at six verses from there, and then we'll draw these threads together. So the first few verses of Psalm 24 read like this: "The earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world and all who live in it, for he founded it, and he established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob." Well, from Greta Thunberg to David Attenborough, from Extinction Rebellion to politicians declaring climate change emergencies, nature and the environment are issues that many people in our culture are deeply concerned about. Issues that people take ever more seriously, not least, I think, because of the growing number of challenges that clearly face the natural world and the environment. For sure, climate change is one of the ones that's most frequently mentioned, but there's a whole raft of other issues that are out there. And in fact, the noise and fuss about climate change often masks some of these other equally important environmental issues. We have the issue of the loss of biodiversity and growing extinction rates. We have issues of deforestation. We have sea level rise. We have pollution, especially plastics in the ocean. And you don't need to be an eco-warrior and spray paint yourself green to see that we have a little bit of a problem. You know, even here in Scotland, a country often described as the best small country in the world, often by the Scottish Tourism Office, here in Scotland, We enjoy wide open moors. We enjoy beautiful mountains, big skies, incredible beaches, wonderful weather. I don't know why people laugh at this, actually. I was in America last week, and people were asking what life is like in Scotland, what the weather is like. And I said, last year we had a fantastic summer. It was on a Wednesday. But despite that wonderful environment we live in here in Scotland, I've had the privilege to live here for the last 4 years. And I'm an outdoors person, I'm a hiker. And as I've explored some of the furthest and wildest flung corners of Scotland, it doesn't matter where you go, whether it's here at this end of this country, or if you go up into the far northwest, if you go up to the islands, to Orkney and further afield, I've begun, particularly on the seashores, to notice the plastic. Plastic is everywhere. Tangled fishing nets, toothbrushes, bottles, millions upon millions of unidentified pieces of plastic littering the rack line. And the same is true globally, actually, wherever you go. A video went viral on the news and on places like YouTube a year or so ago, where images emerged from a small island called Henderson Island. That's a remote atoll in the Pacific. And pictures of a little crab emerged. It was a hermit crab. And it's taken to using, rather than a shell, it found an old plastic doll's head as its shell. And another crab on the same reef was using an empty tub of Avon night cream. Listen to these words from best-selling British environmentalist and landscape writer Robert McFarlane. Robert writes, "What signatures our species will leave in the strata? We remove whole mountaintops to plunder the coal they contain. The oceans dance with hundreds of thousands of tons of plastic waste slowly settling into seafloor sediments. Weaponry tests have dispersed artificial radionuclides globally. The burning of rainforests for monoculture production sends out smog pools that settle into the soils of nations. A nitrogen spike indicated in ice cores and sediments will be one of the key chemical insignias of the Anthropocene, our geological age, caused by the mass global use of nitrogen-rich fertilizer and by fossil fuel burning. Biodiversity rates are crashing worldwide as we hasten into the great sixth extinction event, while the soaring number of a small number of livestock species ensures the geological posterity and the fossil record of sheep, cows, and pigs. We have become titanic world makers, our legacy legible for epochs to come." Well, when it comes to the environment and the natural world, issues that our culture, I think quite rightly, is deeply concerned about, one of the problems is, for those of us who are Christians, is that Christians sadly have a somewhat checkered record, or at least reputation, when it comes to the environment. I was recently reading the wonderful little book, The Last Wilderness, by journalist and nature writer Neil Ansell, and I was quite staggered to come across this little paragraph in the middle of it. Let me read you this wee paragraph from his book and see if you're surprised, or spot, rather, what surprised me slightly the first time I read this. Neil writes, "I was surprised to come upon a man in the depths of the woods. He had a shotgun cocked in the crook of his arm, and he was wearing a deer stalker. He asked me if I'd seen a big grey fox, and happily I was unable to help him. The pine marten lady had warned me that many people locally had a relationship with wildlife that consisted almost exclusively of killing it. It is a rather biblical outlook to see the world solely as a resource placed there for our own benefit." And if you're like me, you're probably quite stunned by that little metaphor he draws upon at the end. The fact that Neil can describe that kind of attitude to the environment as biblical is tragic. It's profoundly saddening. And for sure, we could push back on Neil and say, you know, it's unfair, it's a caricature, it's not a fair representation of what Christians believe or the Bible teaches. But isn't the more important question, where has a journalist of Neil's obvious ability got the idea from that to treat the environment carelessly is a biblical idea? Or where has he also got the idea from that Christians don't care about the environment? And I hear this a lot when I speak on university campuses. I hear students will often say to me, you know, the environment is one of the biggest issues of our day, and Christians simply don't care about it. Where does that idea come from? Well, sadly, there are lots of examples you could point to of Christians, I think, speaking in ways that are profoundly unhelpful. To pick just one example among many, a few years ago, at a big Christian conference in Dallas, Texas, called the Catalyst Conference, the controversial megachurch pastor, Mark Driscoll, said this on the stage. He said, "I know who made the environment, and he's coming back, and he's going to burn it all up. That's why I drive an SUV." You know, this negative attitude towards the environment that has sadly sometimes, I think, caricaturized the approach of Christians, I think one place it has its roots is a misunderstanding of Genesis 1, verse 26, a verse we read earlier. There in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, we read that God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle and the earth, and all the creeping things that creep upon the earth." And I think historically, one of the problems has been that sometimes Christians have been a little bit too quick to take the word dominion there and suggest from that idea that the natural world, that creation is just there to serve us. You know, minerals and materials only exist so we can mine them. Fossil fuels only exist so we can burn them. Forests only exist so we can cut them down. Animals only exist so we can eat them. And animals with no obvious utility value or that aren't tasty on the barbecue are simply inconvenient at best and a nuisance at worst. But this is a deeply flawed understanding of what Genesis is teaching. It's a deeply flawed misunderstanding of the word dominion, actually. I mean, yes, dominion means to rule over something, but it also means to have care and responsibility. So, for example, when you send your kids off to school, you are handing dominion over your children to the school and to the teachers. And presumably, you are expecting to get your children safely back at the end of the day. If perhaps I lend you my car as a sort of kindness to you, I'm giving you dominion over my car. And I therefore presume that when I get the car back, it's going to be in one piece. If 24 hours later you return my car dented and scratched and the seats covered in vomit, presumably you have some questions to answer. You can't simply give, "Andy, you gave me dominion over the Volvo." The same idea, I think, is built into Genesis. God has created an amazing world, a beautiful world, a world that he repeatedly describes as good many, many times throughout Genesis chapter 1. And in fact, throughout the rest of the Bible, we read how much God cares for the world that he has made. We even read in the Gospels that God knows when a sparrow falls from the sky. In other words, as Christians, if we take Genesis seriously, if we take the Bible seriously, we have a powerful mandate to care for and take the environment seriously because it's God's gift to us. And all of this matters profoundly. This issue matters because it's in the headlines, hence why it's in this series, but it also matters profoundly for four other reasons that I want to share with you this morning. Firstly, the environment matters for those of us who are Christians here this morning, because if we claim to love God, if we say we are people who love God, then presumably if we love God, we will love what he cares about. If we love God, we will love what God cares about. And God tells us quite clearly in the scriptures what he thinks about the world. In fact, in one of the most beloved verses in the whole of the Bible, in John 3:16, which maybe many of you here may know by heart, look what that verse says if you read it carefully. "For God so loved the world," which means if we claim to love God, but we don't love what he has made, there is no other option for it but to admit that we are hypocrites. Well, secondly, taking God's creation seriously, I think, is also hugely important, taking the natural world seriously, because it helps challenge our materialism and our consumerism. You know, we live in an age that tells us you are what you own, you are what you buy, you own, you are what you consume. And many Christians, many of us who should, if we are honest with ourselves, know better, have bought into the same ideology. We can equally be as obsessed with our homes, with our jobs, with our cars, with our bank balance, as much as the culture, which consistently tells us that the material things are the only things that matter in life. But a robust and biblical theology of creation is a great corrective to consumerism. You know, as the Christian environmentalist J. Matthew Sleeth wrote in his wonderful little book, Serve God, Save the Planet, he points out, he says, "You are God-made. we have forgotten that we have far more in common with a honeybee than we do with our SUV or our DVD. And getting the environment in the right place in our thinking helps correct this. Well, the third reason why this issue of the environment matters so much, I think, this morning, I want to stress, is because I think only the Christian faith can actually really give us a firm foundation for care for the environment and the natural world. Let me unpack this one in a bit more detail this morning. What do I mean by saying that only the Christian faith can give a real basis for environmental care? Well, I don't know if you've noticed, but behind every environmental campaign, behind every issue or concern, lies the implicit assumption that the issue that's being talked about, be it climate change, plastic in the oceans, rainforest loss, whatever it is this, that this should be an issue that we should care about. Every environmental campaign is based on the idea that this should actually change how we behave, that it should matter to us. But the problem is, why? Whenever someone confronts you with an environmental issue and expects you to, you know, respond accordingly, you can ask the question, why should I care? And that's a real challenge if you don't believe in God. If you are a secular environmentalist, trying to tell people why they should care about the environment is a real challenge. In fact, over the years, there have been several attempts to provide an answer to that question. And it's my claim this morning that all of the attempts by our secular friends actually fail, and that actually this is why the Christian faith is so important when it comes to this issue. But let's take a look at some of the attempts that the secular world has made to tell people why they should care about the environment. The first attempt that's often made is appeal to emotion. You know, lots of environmental campaigns go this way, don't they? Stop driving your large car, or the polar bears will die. Greta Thunberg, who we mentioned earlier, Greta really leans on the emotions quite heavily. She likes to claim that adults are destroying the future for young people and really tugs on the heartstrings. Other environmental campaigns appeal to our compassion. They show you pictures of cute baby animals, hoping they can sort of tug at your heartstrings and generate a response. But emotions are a terrible foundation for environmentalism. They're a terrible foundation. Because what happens if you're talking to somebody who doesn't feel what you feel? What if you're talking to somebody who says, I hate polar bears. Seals, quite frankly, would look better as a pair of gloves on my hands than on an ice floe. How do you respond to somebody who doesn't feel the emotion? The problem is emotions are just personal preferences, and we need something much more solid if we are going to really ground environmentalism. So another secular attempt has been to appeal to how environmental care benefits us. Again, lots of environmental campaigns go this way. We need to stop using pesticides so much, we're told, because they cause human illness, whereas climate change causes sea level rise, putting many towns and cities at threat. And we're told, you know, we should care about things like the loss of bees and insects because they pollinate our fruit and our crops. In other words, on this approach to environmentalism, we are told that we should care about the environment because caring about the environment benefits us. Now, this is certainly a more powerful approach than just appealing to our emotions, but there's another problem. And the problem is, it's inherently selfish. It's completely selfish. It basically says, well, it's going to be really inconvenient for us if these things happen, so we better change our lives. And presumably, of course, bits of nature that don't help us are fair game. If we can't find a use for something, then it doesn't matter if it disappears off the planet. But of course, the other problem is it fails to engage people who don't care about the issues. You know, what do we say to somebody who says, well, actually, I don't care about sea level rise. I live on a hill. I only eat meat, so I don't care about pollinators. And actually, you know, I don't really care about the environment. My lifestyle is set up in such a way that I just don't care. And if this argument is the best you have, you are in real trouble. And so secular environmentalists have tried harder, again, to find a way to ground environmental campaigns that can really give them a basis. A third way that's been tried is to say that we owe it to future generations. We're often told that, you know, we need to bequeath to our descendants and the descendants of our descendants a world that is clean, an ecosystem that is pristine and intact. In other words, to pass on a world to our children and our grandchildren that is better than the one we inherited. And this is a common argument made by many environmental campaigns. But again, sadly, it falls a little bit short. It begs the question, why? Why do we owe anything to future generations? And what do you say to the person who has no children, who says, I don't have any children, I don't plan to have any children, so I don't care about future generations? How can we show them that they should care, that this issue really matters? Well, as these three arguments have really been shown to be weak, I think now the attempts made by some secular environmentalists have got more and more desperate. For example, some secular environmental campaigns have tried to argue that we should care about the natural world, especially animal life, because we are closely related to it. I saw a leaflet recently that said we should care about apes and chimpanzees and so forth because we share 96% of our DNA with them. And that sounds quite impressive until you start asking questions like, why should I care about something just because I have something in common with it? For example, I have carbon atoms in common with a table. And did you know this morning that you have 60% of your DNA in common with a banana? So should we be campaigning for fairer treatment for bananas? I think that probably is bananas. There's the free dad joke this morning. You see, oh, you actually laughed. That's impressive. I do like you folks. You see, the problem with all of this is that at its heart, environmentalism is essentially a moral issue. Essentially a moral issue. You know, it may be very much true that our generation consumes 5 times more energy than our grandparents, who lived more humbly and simply than we did. It may well be true that if you assign weights to the amount of energy used per person, then the average person in China weighs 100 pounds, the average European weighs 1,000 pounds. But those are just facts. To move from those bare facts to insistence that because of them, we should think about how we live, or we should change our habits of overconsumption, or consider the natural world as an end rather than a means, those are moral claims, and moral claims need some foundation. When someone says you should do something, you have the right to ask why. And I want to argue this morning that only the Christian faith, only the Christian worldview can provide the strong foundations that we desperately need for a strong case for a duty of care for the environment. You see, as a Christian, if someone says to me, Andy, why should we care about the environment? I would say, well, quite simply, because God is real. Because we live in a moral universe, because God has commanded us to steward and look after the world, and because the world is God's good gift to us. And a good gift should lead to the emotion of gratitude. You know, one could argue that all Christian ethics actually is based on gratitude. The New Testament frequently says, because of what God has done for us, because of what Jesus has done for us, therefore in gratitude, we should live differently. And when it comes to nature and the environment, God has given us a beautiful world. He's given us an amazing world. He's given us an utterly incredible gift. And treating that gift with care, just as you would treat a wonderful present given to you by a spouse or a beloved friend, is a very fitting response and a powerful basis for creation care. And the fact that the world we see around us, the fact that the environment is God's gift, matters tremendously because gifts tell us something. A gift tells you a couple of things, actually. A beautiful gift tells us something about the giver, and it also tells us what the giver thinks about us. And you see, when we begin to forget that the natural world is God's gift, or when we begin to neglect that gift that God has given us, the result can be something of a deep, deep sickness. In 2007, a new edition of the Oxford Junior Dictionary came out, and some people noticed that the editors of the Oxford Junior Dictionary had edited out a lot of words to do with nature. Gone were words like acorn, beech, fern, newt, otter, willow, all of those words no longer in the dictionary. In their place had come words like attachment, email, chat room, celebrity, and so forth. When challenged, the head of children's dictionaries at Oxford University Press said they wanted their dictionary to reflect the consensus of the experience of modern childhood. Don't you love marketing speak? Something has gone badly, badly wrong if we are raising a generation of children who know what an email is but can't identify a tree. You know, I think everywhere you look in the world, you see people struggling, because we have lost our connection to the world and the environment. And when you lose that connection, you lose the connection to the God who made it. So the Bible makes that connection incredibly clear. And another of my favorite psalms, Psalm 19, we read, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech, they use no words, no sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world." The creation, when we listen to it carefully, has a lot to say about its creator. As J. Matthew Sleeth, who we met a few moments ago, said, he writes, "Can you identify a greater number of trees or cars?" See, if the Bible says that God knows every flower and bird, why do we spend so much effort knowing the names of man-made items? Maybe we are paying attention to the wrong things. Maybe this is why life seems so hard. If this is our Father's world, maybe we should pay more attention to it. Over 100 years ago, the Reverend Maltby Davenport Babcock, they knew how to name people 100 years ago, I tell you, there's a name. He was walking through the beautiful countryside of the Niagara Escarpment near his home on the American border up near Canada. And so moved was he by the scenery that he saw that day that he put pen to paper and wrote a poem to which some music was later set and has now become a very, very, very famous hymn beloved by many people. Some of you may be familiar with these words. This is the hymn that he wrote. "This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest in me the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, his hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise. The morning light, the lily white, declare their maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear him pass. He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus who died, satisfied, and earth and heaven be one." That hymn has become incredibly famous. In fact, the film composer Howard Shore even used the first few notes of the hymn in the score for the Lord of the Rings film back at the beginning of the 2000s. And I speak to many secular friends, actually, who deeply appreciate the first two verses of that hymn. They're very powerful in their description of the wonders of nature. But then many of my secular friends, I think, then struggle a bit with the third verse. They wonder what the third verse is doing there. As one of my friends once said to me, isn't this the kind of shoehorning of Christian theology into what would otherwise be quite a nice nature poem? To which I always want to respond, no. That third verse is crucial. It's absolutely crucial because there is one last question that nature and the environment raise, and it's this: what has gone wrong with the world? Why do we see the environmental struggles and crises that we do? Why does the environment seem so broken, and what can we do to solve it? And it's very easy to tweely respond, "Ark, the answer is to reduce carbon emissions, to stop using plastic forks, to send Greta Thunberg on another world tour." But what if we need something much more profound than those things? One of the most influential environmental scientists of the last few decades is the gentleman on the screen behind me. His name is Gus Speth. He was a senior climate advisor to the US government. He now works for the United Nations in climate advocacy. Brilliant scientist, arguably knows more about the environment than most people in the world. So you would think he would have a pretty good idea how to fix what is going wrong with the environment these days. But listen to his conclusion. He writes, "I used to think that the top environmental problems were biodiversity loss, ecosystem collapse, and climate change. I thought that 30 years of good science could address those problems. I was wrong. The top environmental problems are selfishness, greed, and apathy. And to deal with those, we need a cultural and spiritual transformation. And we scientists don't know how to do that." See, the natural world, says the Bible, in verse after verse after verse, the natural world is like a signpost. Its beauty and its goodness and its wonder are a pointer to the God who made it and how much he loves us. But the brokenness that we see in God's good world are also a signpost. They are a signpost and a sign of the brokenness in you and I, the brokenness in human beings, and how we are separated, not just from the God who loves us, but actually separated from a proper connection with the God, the world that God has made for us, separated from God and estranged from our environment through, as Gus rightly identifies, selfishness, greed, and apathy, what the Bible calls sin. But the good news is that the story of what God did in Jesus Christ, when he went to the cross in our place to deal with our sin and our apathy and our guilt and our alienation and our brokenness, what Jesus did there on the cross is not just the answer to our separation from God, it's also, I think, the beginnings of an answer to the environmental crisis we are facing. Because you see, for me, when I look at the natural world and what's going on out there and our response to the God who made it, a three-word prayer often springs to mind. Sorry, thanks, and please. It's a very helpful framework for praying some of these things through. We can pray, Lord, I'm sorry for the mess that we've made of our world. I'm sorry for my kind of part in it. You know, thanks for the wonderful gift that you have given us. But please, would you work in and through us to put it right? And that's a powerful prayer. It's not a prayer that one should pray lightly. If you pray it taking it seriously, who knows how the Lord may answer it. But it doesn't go far enough. It doesn't go far enough. Because if Gus Speth is right, that the real environmental issues, the bigger issues, are spiritual, then if the Bible is right, that the way to put the world right begins by putting ourselves right with God, then the really exciting thing and the really powerful thing is that three-word prayer we can still use, but we can push even deeper with it. We can use it as our response to getting ourselves right with the God who gave us this incredible gift that we see around us. We can pray, sorry, Lord, sorry that I have been greedy and selfish and apathetic. Lord, I'm sorry that I have ignored you and not been grateful for the gifts that you have given me. Lord, thank you for sending Jesus into the world to die on the cross there for my selfishness, for my brokenness, for what the Bible calls sin and all the things associated with it. Please, Lord, would you forgive me? Would you make me your child? Would you fill me with your spirit? And would you renew me, my heart and my life from the inside out? It's a powerful way to respond to the God of the Bible. And the Bible promises us wonderfully and powerfully and hopefully that for those who put their trust in Christ, who respond to God that way, we can become new creations. God promises to literally remake us. And the Bible also promises that the environmental destruction that we see around us right now is not the end of the world, because God has a plan for creation too in the New Testament. And it speaks not merely the Bible of us becoming new creations, but it speaks about a new heavens and a new earth. The hope that through Jesus, not merely can we be remade, but God's good world will one day be remade too. Sorry, thanks, and please. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you that you are a God of incredible generosity, a God of love, and a God of faithfulness, a God who has given us so many things. We thank you for the incredible natural world that you've given us, and we are sorry for the way that human beings, ourselves included, have treated it. But Lord, we also recognize that the issue goes so much deeper. And some of us here, sure, need to pray sorry, thanks, and please when it comes to the environment. But there are also some of us here who realize that actually we need to pray sorry, thanks, and please in terms of getting ourselves right with you in the first place. Because unless we get our hearts sorted out and that greed and that apathy and that selfishness that lie at the heart of so many of the problems in our age dealt with, then those problems will continue. So Lord, would you meet each one of us here this morning? For those of us who are Christians, help us to rethink if that's required, our attitude to creation and to treat it seriously as our Father's world. And for those who do not yet know you this morning, would you reach out and touch their lives, engage them this morning through your spirit and draw them into a relationship with you? Because this world is a great gift, but an even greater gift is the ability to become a member of the family, a child of the God who made it. We pray all this in and through Jesus. Amen.